For several decades, the main method of covert communications in the espionage world was radio transmissions. For the same reason, counterintelligence services were experts in identifying where radio transmission was coming from, and regularly used mobile and stationary radio direction finding gear to uncover spies communicating with their agencies. Like so, spy agencies decided to start using a one-way communication method, since radio direction finding was relying almost exclusively on detecting transmissions. Why not stop all transmissions? Welcome to Tradecraft Sunday. It's relatively easy for an agency with radio direction finding equipment to pick up that someone inside their country transmitted a signal at a certain frequency by using directional antennas looking for suspicious transmissions. On the other hand, it's pretty hard finding out who is listening to the radio, since it's a passive task. It doesn't usually produce any emissions. It just filters specific frequency, decodes them, and sends them to a speaker or headphones. So starting in the 1950s, more and more spy agencies started utilizing the one-way voice links, or OWVL, covert communications method. This meant the agent operating undercover in a foreign land would only need to listen at a specific frequency for instructions at a specific time of the day. The frequencies typically used were those of the shortwave range. Shortwave includes the entire HF spectrum, 3 to 30 MHz. This wasn't a coincidence, of course. HF is used even today due to a unique feature. Its signals can be reflected back to Earth by the ionosphere layer in the atmosphere, a method called skip wave, allowing long-distance communication beyond line of sight. This meant that even if the agent was operating in a denied environment, in a country far, far away from any stations of the agency, they could still receive those radio signals. To do that, they needed a receiver. Over the years, agencies utilized different receivers for OWVL, but in summary we can group them to three main categories, based on the deniability they provided. The first and most deniable one were commercial, off-the-shelf, radio receivers that happen to support this frequency range. We have demonstrated such an example with the Ilmenau 210. This was the best case scenario, since those could be easily purchased in the destination country without raising any suspicions. And even on a potential search by local authorities, there was nothing incriminating or unusual about having such a radio receiver. However, not all destination countries offer this convenience in their commercial market. This is why the second best option was converters. Those were small custom converters which could be installed in commercially available receivers to extend their frequency range to support OWVL covert communications. Here you see such an example, developed by the West German BND to allow its agents to turn commercial radios into shortwave receivers. Lastly, we have the least deniable option, custom-made radio receivers. A notable such example was the British Mark 301, used extensively by the intelligence services of the United Kingdom from the 1950s all the way to the 1970s. Apparently, those were far more reliable and concealable, but if someone was discovered owning and operating one, it was a big clue that they were a spy. This last type of receiver had some variant that the CIA started to use in the 1960s and the 1970s. They call this the Interim One-Way Link, IOWL, or IO. The main difference was that apart from being tailor-made devices, they had the ability to temporarily store the received signals, meaning the agencies could send them at faster speeds since the agent could record them, leave the site, and later sit in a safe location, replay them at a slower speed and decode them. On one side, IOWL was a covert communications tradecraft improvement, since it drastically reduced the time the agent was exposed receiving the signals. But on the other hand, this meant additional specialized equipment, which increased the risk of compromise if discovered, and additional logistical complexity of the operation to get the device, conceal it, transfer it, use it, and eventually return it or dispose it securely. Having a way to receive and decode the signals is one issue. The other is how to ensure that only you can understand what they say, because otherwise any counterintelligence agency would be just listening to them the same way as the agents, learning everything. For this one, the main method employed at the time were the one-time pads. OTPs were literally small notepads with tables of numbers on each page. Those were unique for each day of the week. Using the exact same OTP the spy had, the agency was encrypting the message using those numbers, and the receiving agent or agents could follow the reverse process to decipher the messages. The downside of OTPs was that it was forcing the agents to have this incriminating piece of equipment with them. However, for security purposes, the typical instructions were to rip the day's page and destroy it at the end of the day. So even if captured, the counterintelligence service would not be able to decipher past communications they might have intercepted. The advantage of the OTP was that unless you had access to the pad used, it was theoretically impossible to decipher the communications. Even to this day, OTPs are considered by cryptologic experts to provide perfect secrecy. That's a formal term to say OTP is unbreakable. Of course, in real life, there have been cases where OTPs were broken, but that was typically due to implementation mistakes. If you want to get a more practical view of OTPs, check out this video that we did some time ago. Soon enough, it was clear that you need a reliable and consistent way for transmitting those encrypted messages, and humans aren't known for being good at either of those. This is how the number stations became popular. Number stations were electronic devices designed to take those encrypted messages in one format, such as a punched card, and at a configured schedule transmit them to another, sometimes with different tones. But most frequently with a pre-recorded voice for each number.
2, 5, 2, 2, 5, 2.
Even to this day, there are still some operational number stations, but we don't know if any spies actively listen for their messages to take some action, if they are just leftover legacy infrastructure waiting to be decommissioned, or if they are there as a contingency plan. What we do know is that every year, less and less of those number stations continue to broadcast, clearly indicating that it's a dying espionage tradecraft. For decades, operatives were relying on OWVL and IOWL cover communications to succeed, but as the world entered the digital age, a whole new spectrum of capabilities appeared. Nevertheless, the foundations of one-way cover communications were adapted and used even with modern technologies. For example, what about reading a seemingly inconspicuous comment in a social media post, storing a secret message in a digital image file, and many more similar one-way covert communication concepts.